coming up on 2020 on ID. The perfect all-American family, torn apart by forbidden teenage love.
One day it'd be fine, and then as fast as you could snap your finger, they'd be yelling and screaming.
Then...
911, what is your emergency?
A grisly double homicide leaves both parents dead.
And it was probably one of the most violent crime scenes that I've ever seen.
And police say the shooter is the couple's own daughter.
And she came running out bawling and says, they think I did it.
A teenage girl stands trial for murder while her family watches and wonders.
I can't imagine her doing that.
Spent shells, a bloody bathrobe, reenactments banned from the courtroom, and a verdict.
Is Sarah Marie Johnson not guilty or guilty of murder of the first degree?
Young Love Interrupted.
Welcome to 2020 on ID. I'm John Quinones. Parents know to expect problems when their kids become teenagers. And Diane and Alan Johnson's 16-year-old daughter, Sarah, have presented them with a very big problem. A boyfriend they thought was wrong for her and possibly dangerous. But no one could have imagined what would happen after they tried to end the relationship. Diane and Alan were murdered. In the aftermath, as Deborah Roberts first reported in 2007, a family found itself torn apart by accusations and grieving over what they had lost.
She was very vivacious, very curious, very loving, very loyal. You couldn't have a better friend than Diana.
I always looked up to Alan and copied him, and he was always just a really great, honest, straightforward guy.
When I see something that reminds me of Diana and Alan, it's something that has a good memory.
Their lives seemed nearly as picture perfect as the resort town they lived in. Married for 20 years, Alan and Diane Johnson were among the successful locals who made their lives on the outskirts of Sun Valley, Idaho, the vacation spot and home to the rich and famous. Alan was part owner of a landscaping business. Diane worked at a medical clinic. Longtime sweethearts, they treasured family, including two children. 16-year-old Sarah, athletic and outgoing, and her brother Matt, a gentle spirit who at 22 had moved on to college.
My mom and dad were my best friends. Probably are still to this day. My father and I worked, did hunting, just hung out constantly.
And your mom?
And my mom, oh man, she's such a wonderful person. And she had the ability to make everybody happy.
In the small, close-knit community, Diane and Alan were known for their lively parties and trap shooting outings. But their focus was their youngest, Sarah. She was Daddy's little princess. Popular and spunky, she excelled in high school basketball and volleyball and was a member of the debate team.
What kind of a kid was she?
When she was younger, she was very nice and she loved playing around with other kids. She just connected with people real well.
Were you too close?
Yeah, we were pretty close.
But the happy family life would come to an end after Labor Day weekend, 2003.
911, what is your emergency? Two gunshots.
Alan and Diane Johnson were brutally executed in their home. Diane shot in the head while sleeping. Alan hit in the chest while in the shower. Their daughter, Sarah, sounding terrified, says she was alone in her bedroom when it all happened. Who could have done it, and how could it happen? For investigators, the first clues would come after a discovery that Sarah had fallen for a boy her parents didn't like. His name was Bruno Santos, an illegal Mexican immigrant and high school dropout from a poor home across town. He was also 19. 3 years older than Sarah.
I remembered him from my freshman year.
Saranga Stark and Shante Caudle played volleyball with Sarah.
I thought she could do a lot better. He was a high school dropout, and was selling drugs, and she came from this really nice family. It just didn't seem like it was right.
And then one night after volleyball practice, you know, she showed their engagement rings. And
engagement rings? Mm-hmm, she was 16 years old.
Yeah, that's what I told her. That's exactly what I told her, because I knew it was somewhat serious. I just didn't know that her parents had a really big problem about it.
In fact, Sarah's relationship with Bruno was the source of heated family arguments, her brother Matt recalls.
I know she had problems with my mom. One day it'd be fine, and then as fast as you could snap your finger, all hell would raise loose, and there'd be yelling and screaming.
Jim Thomas, a county prosecutor, knew the family and had heard about the turmoil.
And Alan was kind of the peacemaker. He hated to see the love of his life, Diane, and then his daughter, who was a jewel in his eye, in this kind of conflict.
Back up at the cabin, you see Sarah there.
Even Diane's older sister and her husband, Linda and Jim Vavold, worried that Bruno was tearing the family apart.
She told me about one incident where she and Sarah had an argument and it became physical.
And Diane slapped Sarah, and she fought back. And Alan had to come in and break it up.
And the tension would intensify Saturday morning before Labor Day, Diane and Alan's last weekend alive. They discovered that Sarah had spent the night at Bruno's apartment. Linda and Jim were staying with the Johnsons that holiday weekend.
Diane was sitting in a chair, and I said, "What's up?" And she says, "Well, we found Sarah with her boyfriend, and Alan's going to go get her." She says, "Why don't you ride with him?" And we pulled in, and I parked right behind Sarah's car, and he went up to the house.
And he told him in no uncertain terms that he was not to have any contact with his daughter, and essentially gave him an ultimatum that he better stay away from his daughter or else.
Alan even threatened to report Bruno to the police for having sex with his underage daughter. But it would never happen. The following Tuesday morning, as neighbors were getting ready for work, gunfire was heard. Alan and Diane were murdered. Sarah, alone and hysterical, ran to a neighbor's who dialed 911 for her.
911, what is your emergency?
Now describe to me, because I can only imagine, you come back home, your parents have been shot, you discover, at what point did you know that they were dead?
Right when I pulled up, the hearse was actually sitting in the backyard, and I wanted to go over in the property, but people were holding me back.
How do you even take something like that in?
I don't know. I can't explain.
And then you see your family, and what was that like?
Just sad. It was just a big circle of hugs and tears.
Yeah. Dean and Pat Dishman, Diane's mother and father, couldn't grasp the horror.
Oh, bless your hearts.
What goes through a mother's mind when she hears that?
You cry and you pray. It's indescribable. It really is the heartache and the sorrow.
At first, it's just, you can't believe it. It's something that's so bad, you can't comprehend it. It just takes a while to sink in.
As family and friends began arriving at the house, everyone was now worried about Sarah and talking about Bruno. Her brother Matt feared for his little sister, who was somehow spared by the killer.
When I said, "Is this a dream?" You're watching in a movie and you see someone pick up a phone. You know, is this a dream? You know, it's, you can't tell reality from fiction at that point.
What did you think had happened?
I thought that somehow Bruno had got in and that he had done it.
When we come back, what Sarah says happened the day her parents died.
She heard one bang and had gone to their door, knocked on it, yelled out, "Mom, Dad," and then heard a second bang.
But is she telling the truth?
When I grabbed some of my investigators and some of the people, I said, "There is something going on here."
Stay with us. When Sarah Johnson began dating Bruno Santos, her parents were horrified. He was 3 years older than she was and a high school dropout. so they told the boy to stay out of their daughter's life. Could that action have cost them their lives? Once again, Deborah Roberts.
It was dawn on Tuesday, the day after Labor Day 2003. Alan and Diane Johnson had just been murdered in their bedroom. Their 16-year-old daughter, Sarah, panicked and hysterical, fled to a neighbor's where they called police.
There's been two gunshots in the bedroom.
So you get here in the morning.
Yes.
Go through these doors right here?
Yeah, come into the front door.
Sheriff Walt Femling, a family acquaintance, wasn't prepared for the sight he'd find.
There was blood and hair on the carpet, it was on the ceiling, it was on all the walls. There was part of a skull cap in the hallway. It was probably one of the most violent crime scenes that I'd ever seen.
Police in the small resort town first thought they were looking at a murder-suicide until they took a closer look at the bloody scene and discovered the murder weapon across the room from the victims, a .264 Winchester rifle.
And I had walked out the back door and said, this is double homicide, and let's close this place down and stop that garbage truck right there. And little did we know that that key evidence was sitting right out here on the street.
Inside that garbage can, bullets from the Winchester rifle, a left-handed leather glove, and a right-handed latex glove, all containing someone's DNA. Until that could be revealed, police were relying on Sarah, hoping for a lead that would help them find the killer.
And what did Sarah tell you at that point had happened?
She said that she heard the shower running and that she heard one bang and had gone to their door, knocked on it, yelled out, Mom, Dad, and then heard a second bang and ran out the house.
What were you feeling for your sister who just went through this?
If this rang true, if this is what happened, that's just horrible. I would be sad to be in a house when that happened.
Poor Sarah.
Yeah.
16 years old.
Of course.
At this point, you're all in mourning, and what's going on with her?
The police were investigating her. The police were investigating Bruno. They thought she was going to up and just take off with him.
We thought it was Bruno. We really did. We thought maybe because he was angry because Diane and Alan wouldn't let him see Sarah.
Investigators had also fingered 19-year-old Bruno Santos, the Mexican boyfriend with a shady reputation as a drug dealer.
Do you go to look for him right away?
Yes. We are sending a team out to try and locate Bruno, and he showed up at the crime scene. So I asked him if he would stay there for a while. We got a warrant for his DNA.
Police fully expected Bruno's DNA to tie him to the evidence they'd found in the garbage. But while they were focusing on him, devastated family and friends noticed something troubling about Sarah. Marguerite Sowersby took note as Sarah's grandparents tried to comfort her.
They were beside themselves. She was patting her grandma on the back as she was crying, and her little friend came up next to her, and Sarah immediately quit crying and started whispering to her. She mouthed, go see if Bruno's okay. And I remember just, it was like someone threw some cold water on me.
Then, as investigators removed Alan and Diane's bodies from the house, they too noticed a coldness and distance from Sarah.
She was sitting on the fence watching it, and the police actually asked her to move back. They were just sitting on the fence.
Was she devastated beyond?
No, you would have thought she was at a baseball game.
And I grabbed some of my investigators and some of the people. I said, there is something going on here. I mean, most 16-year-olds would be hiding. They would not want to sit there on the fence and watch their parents come out in body bags. No way.
By now, Sarah's friends were becoming just as suspicious. Her grief, they decided, didn't appear genuine. And Sarah was preoccupied with hair and nail appointments, hardly the expected behavior of a girl who just lost her parents.
If she did do it.
Then Shantae Caudill remembers a chilling moment during volleyball practice.
She came up to my side and she said, Shantae, find Bruno and tell him that I love him no matter what happens. right when she said that, it was just this awful feeling, and my heart just sunk. And I was like, she did it.
Police were also now wondering if Sarah had some part in the killing of her parents. After hearing about the heated arguments over Bruno, investigators took Sarah's fingerprints and DNA samples and grilled her.
I don't even know how it got there. Seriously, I do not know.
Because there was a flaw in your plan.
I don't have a plan.
Sarah stuck to her story about an intruder who'd committed the murders, though there was no evidence of a break-in.
Sarah.
By now, her mom's sister, Linda Vavel, didn't believe her niece.
I didn't do it.
Every time she went in to be interrogated by the police, her story kept changing. And one time the door was open, another time the door was closed. Sometimes she went out the front door. Sometimes she went back through her bedroom and out the hall.
Maybe she was a confused kid?
Yeah. You'd think that she would have remembered how she left the house.
At that point, I had heard so many lies and
her story was falling apart, yet Sarah's older brother, Matt, tried desperately to believe his sister's account.
One time, I met her at the police station, and she came running out bawling and says, they think I did it.
And this must have hit you like a ton of bricks.
I said, no, they're just making sure they rule you out. That's what I told her.
What he didn't say is that he was having suspicions, too. Bruno Santos's family, who'd been interviewed half a dozen times, had convinced police that he was at home during the murders. Then forensic evidence began coming back from the lab. No match to Bruno. Investigators now had a new theory.
I finally just asked him, I said, well, who pulled the trigger? Was it Bruno? He said, no. I said, then who? And then he said, Sarah.
And what happened for you at that moment?
I couldn't hardly talk. I couldn't believe that my granddaughter was capable of such a thing.
Still, police worried the evidence wasn't strong enough. So instead of arresting Sarah, they sent her to live with her aunt and uncle, Linda and Jim, while the investigation went forward. It was a trying arrangement.
So you're beginning to suspect that you have a murderer living in your house.
Yeah.
And is it hard to even allow yourself to think that?
It was really hard. You just can't even fathom it. But all the evidence that the police were sharing with us, nobody else could have done this crime.
Linda struggled not to let on to her young niece, who was now revealing disturbing nightmares to her aunt.
She said, I had this dream about my parents. And mom was in the kitchen, and she was cooking. And when she turned around, mom's face was all blocked out. And she said, and I was talking to my dad, and there was nothing there on his chest. She said she didn't want to hug him because she didn't want to hurt him. And he said, don't worry, you can't hurt me anymore.
And what did you take this to mean?
I thought maybe her subconscious trying to admit guilt.
The evidence is stacking up, and it's only a matter of time before it all comes crashing down on your head.
Still, Sarah stuck to her story that she was innocent.
And did you absolutely accept and believe this?
Oh, of course. Of course I did.
Did you ever ask her, Sarah, did you do this?
I couldn't. I couldn't ask her. At that point, I was afraid of the answer.
When we come back, police get a break in the case.
And we said, there it is. That's it. Our smoking gun.
But will it be enough? Stay with us.
By mid-October, 6 weeks since the brutal murders of Alan and Diane Johnson, a cloud of sadness and fear had settled over the small, scenic Idaho town where they lived. No one had been arrested, and the 19-year-old prime suspect, Bruno Santos, had been cleared. But his girlfriend, Sarah, the 16-year-old daughter of the murdered couple, was under suspicion. Her family, now watching her closely for investigators, struggled not to let on.
I can't imagine what that pain must be like.
It's hard enough to control your emotions to not go after that person and to not throw anything at her that would tip her off that they think she did it. I was just told to be as nice as I could.
Then, on a Wednesday afternoon, the waiting was finally over.
When the state lab came back and they said, we have Sarah's DNA inside the glove. And we said, there it is.
That was your smoking gun.
That's it, our smoking gun. We got her.
No.
Sarah, your life has changed forever.
You're telling me.
Convinced they had the final piece of forensic evidence in place, investigators questioned Sarah one last time, hoping for a confession.
Sarah, tell me.
I didn't do it.
You did it.
No, I didn't.
As sure as I'm sitting here.
She wouldn't budge. After 45 minutes, Sheriff Walt Fimling made the move he had dreaded. He arrested the now high school junior on 2 counts of first-degree murder.
I did not think she did it. I still don't.
Robert Pangburn, the public defender representing Sarah, says it was no surprise that her DNA was found nearly everywhere since she lived in the house. He accused investigators of being reckless and rushing to find a killer.
What were your impressions of Sarah when you first met her?
She at no point struck me as an evil person, which I think any teenager who would kill their parents would by definition be an evil person. She just struck me as a normal kid.
The arrest of Sarah Johnson would make headlines everywhere. A rare case of a 16-year-old girl charged in the murders of her own parents. It's called parricide and typically involves boys.
We knew all along that was going to be the biggest psychological hurdle I faced in prosecution with a jury, is trying to convince them that this 16-year-old girl acting alone killed her parents in such a violent way.
That was the challenge for Thomas's team as the trial began in February 2005.
He's going to be the most critical witness we've got. So.
They believed they had the forensic evidence to convict, but worried whether they could prove that this once bright, athletic high school girl suddenly became a killer.
We've got direct forensic evidence, the DNA, the blood spatter, the inconsistent stories, the incriminating statements showing a guilty mind.
While her anguished relatives looked on, prosecutors presented grim details of the killing and the evidence. The bullets, some found in Sarah's room.
One of those rounds had Diane Johnson's blood on it.
The leather and latex gloves with her DNA. And Sarah's pink bathrobe, covered in her mother and father's blood, also found stashed in the family's garbage.
It's the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help you God.
Adios.
Yes.
Then they questioned the person who may have given Sarah a reason to kill, the Mexican boyfriend her parents didn't approve of, Bruno Santos.
Me amenazó.
He threatened me.
Que me iba a pegar y me iba a meter a la cárcel.
He told me that if I didn't leave his daughter alone, that he was going to hit me and that he was going to put me in jail.
We simply wanted him to show the relationship that he had with Sarah, which he admitted was a sexual relationship. And just really put a face to this particular witness who we knew the defense was going to be pointing to as the main culprit.
Bruno very easily could have recruited cohorts of his. He was involved in the drug business. And people who are dealing oftentimes have associates who are very violent people capable of the terrible crimes that happened in this case.
That's all I've got, Your Honor.
And though Santos may have given the defense another scenario for the murders,
Your Honor, we have decided not to cross-examine Mr. Santos.
At all?
At all.
Pangburn amazingly declined to question him.
Would you state your name, please?
Melinda May Gonzalez.
Then, 16 days into the trial, prosecutors called a witness who would paint Sarah as a pathological liar. One of her former jail cellmates, Melinda Gonzalez, a convicted drug dealer, testified that Sarah nearly admitted to the killings.
And then one time we're talking, and she said, when the killers killed my parents.
Truth and nothing but the truth, so help you God.
Then one of the toughest moments of all for the family, Matt would have to testify.
She's just not one to admit that she's wrong. She always has to have a last word. She always has to be right.
Did your parents treat Sarah well?
Oh yeah, they did anything for her. They were always trying to make her happy.
The court listened in stunned silence as Matt described Sarah's explosions in the household, the open warfare between her and her mother.
It was constant fighting, bickering back and forth.
Did you ever hear your sister say that she hated your mother?
Constantly.
You testified that Sarah hated your mother, that she actually said this.
Yes,
she actually,
several times.
You heard her say that?
Uh-huh. It was usually in a heated argument. I hate you, you know, trying to punch holes through the floor with her feet, storming off.
Defense lawyer Robert Pengburn tried to smear 24-year-old Matt's reputation, implying that he was greedy, that his motive for testifying was the $500,000 insurance claim.
Do you know where Sarah's share of your parents' estate would go if she were convicted?
I would get it.
No further questions.
I think that he would do anything and everything that he could do to ensure her conviction. Was one of the chief attacking witnesses, obviously a biased witness.
The defense suggested that you were testifying because you were anxious to get the insurance money.
I wouldn't look at it that way. I would say I was helping to find my parents' murderer. I had no idea that there was any insurance money involved until 2 weeks after it happened.
Though his sister showed little emotion, Matt watched her closely throughout the trial.
At one point, we see you try to make eye contact with her. Why? What were you trying to?
Maybe a puppy dog look from her or something. Just, why is this happening to me? Some innocence. But all I got back was a dagger stare. Just cold-blooded.
So you were still trying to feel something from your sister, that yeah, maybe this was all a mistake.
Yeah.
That's all I've got, Judge.
As prosecutors wrapped up their case, emotions were running high amongst family and friends of the Johnsons. Despite the scientific evidence, many, like Lorna Kolash, Sarah's godmother, were shattered by the new picture they saw of Sarah.
I couldn't believe that this young girl, who had always been sweet and nice and courteous to me, that she could do such a thing. And it breaks your heart, because I just couldn't bear to have her be the one.
When we come back, the defense presents its case.
The gun itself had blood on it, yet there was none on her. Absolutely not.
Including a reconstruction of the brutal murder. But will the jury get to see it?
We have asked this court to exclude evidence.
Stay with us.
It was early March 2005, 3 weeks since the start of now 18-year-old Sarah Johnson's murder trial. She was accused of parricide, killing her own parents, Alan and Diane, because they didn't approve of her boyfriend. The trial was being watched all over the country, and the defense was about to present Sarah's case. The stress was taking its toll on her brother Matt.
It was another world. It was almost like putting yourself in one of those reality TV shows. I just felt like I needed to be there for my parents every day.
Our job is to show you places where the state has failed to make its case.
Robert Pengburn, the public defender, would try to convince the jury that the forensic evidence, Sarah's blood-stained pink bathrobe and the bloody latex glove, both containing her DNA, didn't prove that she pulled the trigger.
We're going to bring scientists in here who are going to show you the state did a very poor job of hanging on to the evidence.
We had a case based on scientific evidence that's clearly pointed to the fact that she not only didn't do it, she couldn't have done it.
But a bloody glove and robe that had Sarah's DNA on it?
Well, she lived in the house. Having her DNA on her own robe is not at all unusual. There was never any direct evidence that tied Sarah to this case.
Michael Allen Howard.
In fact, Pangburn brought in experts who said if Sarah had pulled the trigger, she should have been covered in blood, which she wasn't.
If you're shooting somebody, you're going to be getting tissue disruption. You're going to be in particles of tissue, sometimes bone.
Her mother's head literally exploded in a spherical fashion. The gun itself had blood on it. Yet there was none on her. Absolutely none. None on her face, none on her eyebrows, none on the piercings of her ears, her nostrils, into her hair. None. Absolutely none.
The evidence will show you no blood, therefore no guilt.
Pangburn built his entire defense on the no blood, no guilt strategy.
State's Exhibit 56, this is Johnson lying in the bed.
Day after day, his team presented graphic crime scene photos to prove their point. It was traumatizing to the friends and family members who jammed the courtroom.
Some of the evidence photos nobody in their right mind should see.
You see somebody laying there that you used to know as a live person, so you just kind of detach yourself from it a little bit. You just have to. It's too hard otherwise.
And there's blood spatters to the right of the sink.
Even Sarah, who remained distant through much of the trial, broke down in tears as she stared at pictures of her murdered parents.
Was it genuine?
I don't know if she's putting on a show or not. Sometimes I thought she was. Sometimes I thought she was hurting. I don't know. I got mixed emotions from it.
But Matt's uncle, Jim Vavold, was certain that Sarah's tears were just an act.
There's one occasion I was watching Sarah and her lawyer, and he tapped her on the shoulder and she started crying. And that went on a little bit, and then everything went back to normal again. That's when I realized that gal could really put on a good show if she has to.
But even before the defense began its case, they suffered a serious blow to their no blood, no guilt strategy.
We have asked this court to exclude evidence of this reconstruction of the court.
Pangburn wanted to play this videotape demonstration of an exploding coconut, certain that it would graphically show how messy the shooting was and how Sarah should have been covered in blood. But the judge wouldn't allow it.
Obviously, I disagree with the judge because I think it would have been helpful to show that in a near point blank shot like this, no matter what that container is, it's a carton of milk, a coconut, a human head. It's going to explode and create a spherical explosion.
Then the critical decision. Would Sarah take the stand and tell in her own words what happened in her parents' bedroom that early morning in 2003? It was no surprise to prosecutor Jim Thomas when she did not.
I just think it would have been very difficult for this 16-year-old to come up with a credible explanation as to why things were so different, the version she gave to various people.
Finally, after 6 weeks, closing arguments.
Stuff
Robert Pangburn, the defense lawyer.
No blood, no guilt. That's what this case is about. Now, what the state has told you here is that, you know, don't worry about that. Don't worry about the fact that she doesn't have any blood on her. Don't worry about the fact that she doesn't have any brain tissue on her.
And Jim Thomas, the prosecutor.
I think if you look at each piece that we've put, piece by piece by piece, you're going to find out the face on that puzzle is Sarah Johnson, and that's who committed this murder.
Sarah's fate was now in the hands of the jury, 4 men and 8 women. Her family, nearly at the breaking point, was now convinced of her guilt.
It takes a lot of evidence to convince a grandmother that her granddaughter killed her daughter. And it just got to the point where it was no one else. Nothing pointed to anyone else, and everything pointed to Sarah. She did it.
Coming up, the verdict that will seal Sarah Johnson's fate.
Is Sarah Marie Johnson not guilty or guilty of murder?
And Sarah speaks for the first time since the trial began.
I loved my parents and I love my family.
The conclusion of our story when we return.
On Wednesday morning, March 16th, after 2 days of deliberating, jurors had reached a verdict in the murder trial of 18-year-old Sarah Johnson. She'd been accused of violently killing her parents, Alan and Diane. There'd been 6 weeks of tear-filled testimony, and friends and family now awaited the decision.
Sarah was crying, and her defense team had probably told her to hope for the best but expect the worst, and I think that's what she was doing, because she was crying before the jury came in.
Is Sarah Marie Johnson not guilty or guilty of murder of the first degree? Answer, guilty.
Guilty on both counts of first degree murder.
That was probably one of the single hardest points of that whole situation, was hearing the guilty verdict.
Why? Given that you felt at that point that your sister was guilty.
I knew what I knew. I just needed to get confirmation from outsiders that this is really what happened.
Defense lawyer Robert Pengburn continues to believe that his teenage client was wrongly accused.
So you believe there are murderers out there on the loose still?
Yeah, I do, yes.
Why didn't the jury believe this?
I don't know.
But prosecutor Jim Thomas is convinced the guilty verdict will now put away a dangerous young woman.
There's something wrong with the hard wire in her head, and the fact that she could commit this crime in such a horrendous, violent way and then have so little reaction afterwards simply shows me that she was just a stone-cold killer.
You eliminated that right back. I'm right-handed.
Dr. Michael Wellner is a forensic psychiatrist and consultant to ABC News. He never met Sarah Johnson, but after reviewing our tapes, explained how a seemingly normal 16-year-old girl could commit such an awful crime.
You have to depersonalize in order to kill. Anger helps that happen. Revenge helps that to happen. People should see this as a volcano erupting. And when they erupt, they destroy everything around themselves.
So you're saying she just stopped looking at her parents as people?
Absolutely.
And just took it out on them?
Absolutely.
2 months after the verdict, Sarah's sentencing. Should her young age spare her a life term? Not according to her family and friends. One by one, they all ask that she be locked away for the rest of her life.
And do you have a statement that you would like to make for the court here today?
Yeah, I prepared a written one, but I'd like to speak from the heart.
Especially her angry brother, Matt.
Sarah, Mom and Dad treated you like a princess. I don't know why you threw it away. Of all the things I miss their hugs. Their bear hugs. And Judge, I would like to see the maximum, because after tomorrow and you read your sentencing, I don't want to ever have to hear about her or this event ever again.
Matt's testimony during sentencing was very powerful. I think it was a combination of anger, of rage, of sadness, of confusion.
Sarah, I'm not talking to the court, I'm talking to you.
77-year-old Pat Dishman stared directly at her granddaughter, pleading for an explanation, anything to explain how she could have viciously killed her own parents.
We have been devastated, absolutely devastated by the deaths of your dad and mom. And the devastation was even worse when we had to come to the realization of who did it. I just needed to talk to her and tell her how broken we all were and ask her why. Why? And I think I ended by saying I still loved her, because I do still love her, and that I would pray that her soul would find its way back to God.
Okay, Ms. Johnson, it's your opportunity to address the court if you so wish.
For nearly 2 years since the murder of her parents, Alan and Diane, finally Sarah Johnson would speak in court.
I loved my parents, and I love my family. With the guidance of the Lord and the continued love and support of those that believe in me, I hope to rebuild my life and prove that I can be a productive member of society.
Her family and friends, desperate for some kind of explanation, would get little more than tears from the teenage girl who continued to insist on her innocence.
I didn't feel any emotion in that at all. I felt like she's just trying to reduce her sentence.
So what my judgment, Ms. Johnson, is with respect to count one, crime of the murder of first degree, unified sentence of life.
She will spend every waking hour and sleeping hour of her life, the rest of her life, her entire adult life, incarcerated.
Not like
Sarah's once close high school friends still struggle to understand how the carefree girl they knew could be a killer.
She's never going to be married. She's never going to have kids. I mean, she's not going to have a wife. And that's sad when you are 20 years old and you don't get a wife.
Sarah's life is now confined to a cell like this one. She's refused to see family or friends.
How much does it hurt?
It's still really hard.
A lot?
Mm-hmm. It's still really hard.
Do you still love Sarah?
That's what I'm having the trouble with. I can't imagine her doing that. It's just unbelievable.
You know, there was absolutely no reason for her to do what she did. She loved her dad so much, and he loved her. And if she could do that to him, what's to stop her from doing it to somebody else? We need to make sure that she's somewhere where she can't do that to anybody else.
Time has done little to ease the devastation in this small Idaho resort town. Alan and Diane Johnson are still the subject of conversations, and their family and friends still ask why. Why did a young girl who seemed to have it all shatter her world and theirs?
Every once in a while, I'll get upset with something, and I can still hear Diana say, "Mom, don't sweat the small stuff." And I laugh. And that's the way people do remember them. They remember the good, the fun, and the wonderful people they were. Can I cry now?
For Matt, the pain goes deeper.
My heart goes out to Matt. I just can't even imagine losing both your parents like that. I feel bad that he's been robbed of his mom being a grandma and his dad being a grandpa and, you know, all the things that he's not going to be able to share with them.
He not only lost his parents, who were once his best friends, but he also lost the little sister he once vowed to love and protect.
Do you really not want to hear from Sarah ever again?
I really have no intention on contacting her.
But she's your sister.
But she killed my parents.